my classroom. Thanks, somebody's already here. I'm glad to see that, although it's not showing up where it's supposed to in the control room. Oh, look at me, all bundled up. I was sitting outside because I enjoyed a little sunshine, but I don't need to be all this bundled up. But for a second, I'm going to stay this bundled up because it feels good to be this warm. Let me show you, I'm going to show you a couple of videos. Today, what are we talking about? Well, we are talking about our amazing brain, right? So we are still in our book on Oop, there it is. There she is. No, kinda. No, there we go. Okay. So, sorry about that. Oh, Didn't have that turned off, did I? So you got my search face is what I'm saying. Hold on. No more search face. Okay, so we are in our book, right? Which I have to borrow again. Life, how did we get here? Evolution or creation? So a really excellent book. And now we are on, I'm moving to, I mean, look at this chapter here, which we're not going to go through. I talked about, but just the different kinds of nests. In evolutionary theory, remember what we're talking about, right? We're talking about evolutionary theory, how did we get here? In evolutionary theory, the idea is that there is, we sort of commune on a trait that is best for survival, right? Then why such a variety here in birds' nests, right? There should be one kind of bird nest that is the most sufficient, efficient for birds, right? Or at least some variation depending on climate, right? I know they're all nests, so it is a variation, but not these kinds of intricate variations, similar to the single-celled organisms that we saw with such great variation as well, right? What is the reason that we would have such delicate single-celled organisms, so delicate in fact, that they look like glass, that they're called glass here in this book. They're literally called glass. Let's get this back on track. It's not where we were. And now on chapter 14, so we've gotten into the idea that, so in nature, the variety far exceeds explanation for a single efficient way of surviving. Why so many niches, right? So now we're moving on though to the human component of this. And actually a lot of my PowerPoint contained information from this chapter because I jumped ahead and then went back for the environmental biological evidence for life being much more complicated than what is described in evolutionary theory, which is not evidentiary. No evidence. Zero evidence. Big words. You're not evidentiary. Okay, so lots of stuff here about neurons in the human brain. And we did talk about this. We looked at neurons and we talked about the axons and the synapses. But what we didn't do is one of the things we didn't do is we didn't go here and look at the descriptions that we see here in the book on the human brain, if you remember, right? I was here, I said we're going to skip past that and we're going to talk about the numbers of connections that are astronomical. Yeah, we haven't even talked about the universe either. I was jumping to a universe idea and without having a way to connect it, and it doesn't connect. So what I got today now for you is a couple videos that I want you to see on the human brain, okay? Whoopsie, that's not really what I wanted to do because then you're back to watching me this way. There we go. Okay. So let me go here to you, me. Okay, so I want you to see this. And was the inspiration for the following video, which inspired me just watching the video, and then I was inspired to have you see the video as well. All right, so I want to show you this. This is Hazel Scott. So while we're watching this, clearly that's not Hazel Scott. Clearly, I'm not Hazel Scott either. But I have a video of her. And while we're watching this, what I want you to see is here, clearly got the idea from the book. So, right here, we've got the picture of somebody playing the piano. The brain is a very big place in a very small space, and what happens in this small space defies human understanding. For example, imagine what must be going on in the brain of a pianist playing a difficult musical composition with all fingers flying over the keys. What an astonishing sense of movement his brain must have to order the fingers to strike the keys, the right keys, at the right time with the right force to match the notes in his head. And that was Carl Sagan. No animal brain ever conceived such things, much less is able to do them. No animal conceived such things. A chimpanzee, whether or not they share 99% of the DNA with us, or that's just a fabrication, cannot even conceive of playing the piano to the extent that we will see here now. Let me make sure I've got my, because I've had such a bad connection. Let me look at the control room. Okay, there we go. We still have connection. Even though we have 21,000 dropped frames. Thanks, Xfinity. I love what you do for me. Oh, wait, I don't know. Oh, wait, I was looking at the wrong thing. Hold on. Okay, I'm still connected. I had to make sure I was still connected. Now. So that you can see is where I got the concept from for what I then went on to videos to see, right? So this piano and that excerpt and that quote from Carl Sagan was the inspiration for what I'm going to show you now. All right. So let me go back here. Let me go here. What are you looking at? You're looking at that. Okay.
On FanDuel Casino, new players get up to $1,000 back in.
Okay, I didn't want you to hear that commercial. So I'm gonna show you now the inspiration for the video that I saw. This is Hazel Scott. Let me see here. Wasn't supposed to sound so. So we don't have to see those ads to get you addicted to something else, gambling. Okay, now I just want you to watch the finger. So remember, an animal couldn't even conceive of playing music, right? This is what we're supposed to have evolved from. 99% of our DNA is shared with chimpanzees, according to science. But could they conceive of making music? And to what extent could they be taught to do this? Okay, so truly amazing finger work, right? Truly amazing finger work, nothing close. If you could get an animal to bang on some keys and then become disinterested in seconds, and that would be the extent of their skill with 99% of our DNA shared, that would be the extent of that monkey's skill on the piano. That is Hazel Scott, who is the inspiration for who we know as, I forgot her name. Oh my gosh, I looked her up. Oh my dear gosh. I'm so embarrassed. Alicia Keys. So Hazel Scott, who happens to look like Alicia Keys' mother, right?
People ask me all the time about.
I don't want you to hear the commercials.
much about the people and the music that have inspired me. And I want to give a shout out to Hazel Scott, because I always wanted to play two pianos. Yes. But back to the music, you know, music, it just, you know those songs that just live inside of you? It lives inside of me, and you just love it so much because it was done so well that you wish you wrote it. That's how I feel about these songs. I wish I wrote them. So when I think about heartache or heartbreak, I think about this song, and I want y'all to help me sing it if you know it. Happy birthday to this beautiful lady.
Yeah. dynamic duo who...
Woo! I have to say, I always need a second after I see her perform. I do. And it is because, again, how can that be? How can what she says and all the meaning of everything that Alicia Keys is saying in the music and to the audience in that performance? Did you see the audience when she was playing their song? I don't like you to see me getting teary-eyed when it's like teary-eyed over something that seems so silly, right? Like that. But I also want you to sort of appreciate that it's not just that she can play the piano to such a expert degree, right? Just an expert at that. In fact, you know, I don't even know the person who invented the piano, if they invented the piano with that in mind, that somebody would eventually do that on the piano. I can't imagine. I mean, maybe, you know, because they invented the piano. Who did that, I wonder? Anyway, but then, like, because somebody who have invented the piano almost had to, like, be the person who invented music, right? I mean, it had to be that early on in music, right? Mm-hmm. Seems weird. But did they ever conceive that somebody would do that with the piano, right? So I'm gonna, yeah, that's what I wanted to do. So you could see it there. I'm gonna blow that up a little bit for you. While I'm talking about it, right? So did anyone ever conceive that that's the, you can see I got a warning there. So that's our playback. You're seeing our playback there. And so you can kind of see what I'm talking about right there in the playback, even though it's not great, choppy and everything like that. But, what she's, so did the piano player, and although they've got her mostly her face and not her keys, which is the reason why I went and showed you the Hazel thing, because the Hazel Scott was her actual hands and really focusing that camera on what she's doing on those keys. But this is, you know, where she's literally playing here dual pianos in this. Did the inventor of the piano ever conceive that a player, pianist, would be able to elevate their skill to that level? I looked up Sean Hayes and the beauty and elegance of his classical piano playing. He's a classically trained pianist, right? There she is, playing both pianos right there. And then on top of that, like with the sexiest vibe you could possibly get, and the people are so excited. Look at that. Look at them. They're so excited in the audience that she might be playing a song that she wishes she wrote. And the meaning in that for those audience members. So it's not just that she can sing, that she looks so beautiful and elegant, that she is one of the foremost expert professional pianists probably out there, right? But that she created unforgettable meaning, not because she played the dual piano, but because of what she said. Because of what she said. Look at her. How excited she is. Look at her. She is so excited. Alicia Keys is playing her song. Or maybe her favorite song. Or whatever. And she's rapping. And she's playing rap songs and she's putting her spin on it, which everybody then wishes they wrote it that way instead. And we are saying that we came from monkeys, chimpanzees, because we share 99%, even though 100% of them are incapable of 1% of this kind of behavior. How's that for percentages, right? Okay, now let's get to our DIY. So where we left off was, we left off with, so the brain of a child is pre-programmed to learn complicated languages quickly. But chimps can barely, you know, communicate their needs. I don't know what it says exactly there. Now, I don't think I talked about this with you specifically, but the cerebral cortex, and this information, again, is from the life, how did we get here, evolution or creation. So complex thinking and language occurs in the cerebral cortex. And we know this because the cerebral cortex gets information, but then has to send it all over the place, right? Has to pick up the information, but then has to send it all over the place, as in it needs to send it. Let me see if I got Safari off now. I do. It needs to send it in to pick up the information from all of our senses, and our sense information is deeper in the brain. So occipital lobe to be able to see, and hear, temporal lobe for our hearing, and parietal lobe up here for our balance. And to balance something, we need proprioception. That's what I was thinking of the other day, which I don't have very well. A sense of where your body is in space and time. So I'm not like bam, 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 right? With the book. Okay. So the cerebral cortex. And that is only 3 millimeters thick. Now you could see the cerebral cortex there on the monkey, right? The chimpanzee, our closest relative, which is significantly thinner than the cerebral cortex for our, it's involved in complex thinking, but it's actually, it's involved in complex thinking and problem solving, because what it does is it interrelates what we're picking up in the real world with making sense of the information. The cerebral cortex is 3 millimeters thick. In the human being, it's 1 millimeter thick. So it's 3 times the size of that in chimps. There is the cerebellum, a picture of the cerebellum, and the cerebellum helps us with instinctual motor skills. So you can see that the cerebellum is close to the same size in proportion and larger in proportion in the chimpanzee's brain than it is in the human brain. So we can see that our brains are balanced for balance, for body movements, for getting our bodies right in our physical space, more important for the chimpanzee, where critical thinking skills are more important for the human being, which then equates to a significantly, dramatically, dramatic differences in skills. Now, I also have here this bottom, the bottom stem there that is yellow, that is our, there's a bundle of nerves then that go up into the brain, right? And we can see the cerebellum is down there, which is gray, right? To help our balance. So when information comes in, the very first thing that we need to do is get it all balanced in our head and our body, right? Get our body ready for, fight, flight, you know, contentment, understanding, deep thinking, get our body ready, right? But the very first pieces of information going to the brain come in from our senses through that yellow bundle, that yellow area there, which has a bundle of nerves called the reticular formation. That reticular formation is responsible for weeding out all the unimportant information that our senses pick up. Because our senses cannot give as much weight to every piece of information. Millions, if not billions, of bits of information are coming in. And in this, what ends up happening is our brain has to weed out. Did you weed it out? Did you say important, unimportant? Is that what you're doing? Important, unimportant. The hum of that, the heater in the background, unimportant. Different than the lights, unimportant. The color of the tree over there, unimportant. Looking at this control panel, important. Watching my signal, important. Paying attention to my words, important. I'm speaking while I'm watching a control panel, while I'm watching my signal, while I'm paying attention to the lights in my eyes, all kinds of things are going on. And my reticular formation is weeding out all that unimportant information, whether it's the picture here I see in the background or whether it's the light I see in my foreground. All of that is unimportant for me right now to be able to speak what I'm speaking. Although not exactly that, because then it was important when I pointed to it, right? Reticular formation. Reticular formation weeds all that out. And this is one of the reasons why I say you are just completely eliminating important data about the natural immunity and our natural defense systems relative to our health, our mental and physical health, relative to our well-being when you give us synthetic drugs on day one. How could you possibly know how that, you tell me your studies that you've done on the effects of vaccines on the reticular formation? Because I want to know. I want to know what is the effects of vaccines, since we have all kinds of people who have sensory overload and all kinds of fancy names and now medications for children experiencing sensory overload. So I might want to know what your medication is doing, not just to my kidneys, because my lifespan is 20 years on average less when I take prescription medication, but I might want to know what that prescription medication is doing to my reticular formation. I want to know why we have whatever you call pterokinesis or whatever that is, what's happening to my cerebellum when I take that prescription medication for depression that results in tardokinesia, whatever that is, right? Right? So it's not a stunting of movement. It's an movement, right? Involuntary movement. What did your medication do to my cerebellum? I want to see those studies. You haven't done them. What are you looking in a file for right now? Why are you looking in that file? Why are you looking there? You didn't do the study. You know it. Just say, we didn't do the study. I have no idea how our medication affects people's reticular formation or their cerebellum or their Broca's area or their Wernicke's area. No idea at all. None. Zero. Mm-mm. Never did the studies. Just say it. Just say it. You'll be free. You'll just be free of all of your misinformation. This gives you an idea of the things that we naturally learn. And also, FYI, don't forget that that Hazel Scott was playing that piano, dual pianos, at a time when people were professing black people couldn't learn. All you need is one. All you need is one. That's it. So demonstrating now the development of words that also has this innate process. Remember what I said, when something is on board when we are born, then It can't be explained by the environment. Language cannot be explained by the environment. Children learn language all in the same way. And we are able, despite our limited intellect, to teach all of our children language given minimal effort. They learn it very readily. But look at how complex language is. We are learning individual sounds like mm, 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 mm. Those are phonemes. And morphemes are when we put them together. Da, 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 ma, ma, ma. They're learning phonemes and morphemes to make words out of sounds without us ever knowing the details of teaching that. The systematic rules, syntax, the systematic rules for forming sentences. Now, this is extraordinary. How we teach it. How do you teach your child that this is a book? What do? You say, this is a book, child, say book. No, what do? You say, you say book, book, book. You could say it, book, right? How does a child know mama ball? When they want something, they know mama ball, right? And then they point to it, or mama cookie. How do they know that? This is a very simple instinctual behavior that's called joint attention that we can't get monkeys to do. We can't get monkeys to look at what I'm pointing at and understand that that's what I want you to do. I want you to look at what I'm pointing at. And then if I'm pointing at it, not only that, but I understand you want that. You want to, a child doesn't even have to say. If they have cookies, they point to the cookies. I know without you speaking a word that you want a cookie. That's called joint attention. That's what joint attention is. The teacher puts up a globe and everyone looks at the globe. They all are together, joining together and putting all their attention on what you want them to, right? Read the book, turn to page 35. Very simple command. A monkey will never do it. A monkey will not even know. They might do it. They might do it if they really wanted the banana and you pointed to the banana and then they would go run over to the banana. So they could do it. But every time I want you to look at something, I'll get you to do it without any struggle. We can't even get monkeys to do joint attention. Do you understand? So, and that is required for learning. Joint attention, whoops. Joint attention is required for learning. I can't draw your attention to something if you don't know how to join me in attending to that, right? So, syntax is the system of rules for forming sentences. So children say one word, right? And then they say two words. They begin to, and then they put together. So it's banana, mama banana, daddy home, daddy sit, daddy read, right? And this is across all cultures, across all time, the way complex language and all these different languages develop exactly the same way. So if you recall, I was talking a while back when we were introducing this part of this DIY, topic on eugenics. When we were talking about this a while ago, what we were saying is that, so you think about that, all these different languages. So Spanish develops the same way as English does, develops the same way as Chinese. If you look at it, that alphabet looks very, very different. But the way language develops is exactly the same way. So it says, I've got a place in my brain that's on board. When I'm born, where did it come from? Before, the universities had two choices, nature versus nurture. And they always said it was nurture, the environment. It comes on board with the environment. Language. So why is it, it's not that we don't learn things from other people as far as language goes, right? But how is it that the idea of learning from our environment is that we're rewarded, but you're not, children are not punished for saying incorrect grammar. They say mama up. You say, yay, you said mama up. You said mama up, yay. Instead of saying, no, grammatically correct sentences are, mama, can you please pick me up? We don't only reward grammatically correct sentences. So how is it that we have learned to speak grammatically correct? We know where the verb goes. We know that there needs to be a subject. You don't even have to learn that. And you do automatically use subjects and verbs appropriately. It cannot all be from learning. And that was the debate between, a while back, probably on day 114, between Noam Chomsky and, was it Bandura? Or was it Thorndike? I'm pretty sure it was Thorndike. I should look it up, though, because it is kind of important. Oh, it is B.F. Skinner. It wasn't Thorndike. It was B.F. Skinner. So Noam Chomsky and B.F. Skinner. And you could look it up. It's a very famous debate. But hands down, Chomsky won that debate. And yet, we continued to teach for another 60 years. And Chomsky still has never gotten real credit. The only people who really know Chomsky's contribution to this topic are people who are really deep in the field of language and science. And I'm not even that deep in the field, but because I do a nature-nurture thing, right, I know a little bit more than most people on the topic. Okay, where are we? Now, what I wanted to show you here is how we pick up information that influences us. How do we know what information you're picking up that influences you? And this is a very simple paradigm to know what's important. So what do? They put eye trackers on individuals' eyes, and then they give them a direction, which is put the apple on the towel in the box. And then what I'm able to see with the eye trackers is what I look at first, second, and third. And this helps us understand how the brain uses and selects information using, for example, the eyes, and then incorporates that information. These are paradigms that scientists are using in order to determine how you problem solve. Where, you know, when you say a link, is there really just a link between chimpanzees and a good scientific study? Is there really just a link? That's it? Between those two things? Is there really simply just a link between the chimpanzee who can and can't play the piano? Just a link. Or the chimpanzee who can't and the human who can? There's just a link. That's it. Okay. All right. Cutting it a little short, 5 minutes short today, because that's all that I have. That's it. I think I made my point. We might be done. We might be done with my book. I'm not done with it, right? In fact, I might just be getting a copy for the first time, hopefully, maybe this weekend, right? So I'm not done with the book, but we might be close to getting done. The one thing that we haven't really discussed and looked at by itself was the universe. And of course, the universe is extraordinary, but I find what is more extraordinary is really Earth itself. And my supposition is that, well, It's a beautiful planet. And if there is other life, that other life would notice our planet because it is such a beautiful planet. It makes all of its own oxygen and carbon dioxide. It is an ecosystem in and of itself that works in perfect harmony. And all by accident, just letting you know, just by accident. What the heck? Who could have thought of that? Absolutely nobody. This is Dr. Annette Feravich. Thanks for sticking around so I can fill up the rest of my hour with our DIY psychologist, do-it-yourself psychologist. What's the first step? And really being able to have stability in your mind, your body, in your spirit, in your soul. What's the first step? It absolutely is knowing your creator. What's the second step? Oh, I think I already said something else was the first step, wasn't it? That's early birds. That's what we were supposed to do. Early birds. I got it. I wrote it down someplace. Where'd that go? This is Dr. Annette Feravich. Thanks for sticking around. I will see you tomorrow with our early birds. Thanks.